the problem must go.
This afternoon, return joy to you in the name of Jesus.
Every arrow and every shoot that you will break,
yes,
in the name of Jesus.
I command every door of favor, every door of breakthrough,
yes,
every door of blessing,
yes,
to swing open for you and all yours in the name of Jesus.
And 2 weeks ago, I built on it, on what the foundation that he had laid. I started talking about walking in divine favor. Hallelujah. And just briefly, because if you are like me, it will take hearing and hearing and hearing before the word sticks. So I will just do a quick revision. We looked in the book of Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 to 3, that says, the Lord said to Abraham, get out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house to a land that I will show you. I will make you a great nation and I will bless you. I will make your name great and you shall be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you and I will curse those who curse you. I will curse him who curses you. And in you, all the families of the earth will be blessed. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And I said that blessing is a special favor of mercy. A mercy or benefit, a favor or gift bestowed by God, thereby bringing happiness. Blessing encompasses the opposite of all the curses that Adam brought into mankind. I went on and spoke to us about how God needed people, when he created. I told you about what we do in Bible studies on our Wednesdays now, about the reason why God created Adam. And when Adam missed it, you know, God created Adam so that he could have somebody to pour his goodness upon. God created Adam so that he could have someone to fellowship with. But when Adam committed the high treason and got out of fellowship, God began to look for somebody else to pour his blessing upon. Because God is all good. Everything in him is good. So he's always looking for ways channels to bring out his blessing. So he now found someone that was faithful enough to be able to take those blessings. And the Lord told Abraham, he found it in Abraham, and told Abraham that I'm not only going to bless you, but through you, nations of the earth will be blessed. Now, God was not looking at Abraham as a single man and Sarah as a single woman. When God was looking at Abraham, he was looking at you. He was looking at you and he was looking at me. And millions of other people on the surface of the earth, that Abraham will be a blessing to, and then will replicate that blessing. I want to talk to us about the definition of favor. That favor means to regard with kindness, to showcase or to preview someone, to endorse someone, to aid or to support someone, to assist someone. And I said favor is a major characteristic of the blessing. Now, how do we get into it? I talked to us briefly. I want to just let you know again that us getting into the blessing is not an accident. It's something that God had orchestrated even from Adam in the Garden of Egypt. Because when you look at the life of Abraham, you will find out that the blessing or the favor that was upon him was replicating. When he came to Isaac, the Bible said that Isaac increased more than Abraham. He went down to Jacob. Jacob increased more. Then going down the line, even the children of Israel, I found out that in the book of Numbers chapter 6, when God told Aaron to bless the children of Israel, he said that the Lord will lift up his countenance upon you. And when I looked up what lift means, it means that he will look unto you with favor. So the Lord Almighty began to orchestrate this thing, and when he got to Mary, the Bible said Mary was highly favored. And then Mary now came back to Jesus Christ, and the Lord, the scripture says in the book of Luke that Jesus increased in favor. And you and I belong to Jesus. And the Bible tells us in the book of Psalm 102 verse 13, it says, Psalm 102 verse 13, put it up for me quickly so that I don't misquote. It says, you will arise. mercy on Zion. Zion is the church, the body of Christ. For the time to favor her, yes, the set time has come. So now, the favor of God has gone into big, you know, it has expanded. It went on to increase and to increase and to increase. And now it has gone to a level where that every individual that belongs to the body of Christ has abundance of favor upon them. So you as a Christian, as a child of God, because we talked about it the last time, that how did we fit into it? We were fitted into it by Christ Jesus. The only requirement for you to get into the blessing, to get into the favor of God, is to be born again. To be linked to Abraham's favor in Galatians chapter 3, the only requirement is to be born again. Galatians chapter 3, verses 13 to 14. Galatians chapter 3, 13 to 14 says, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. And verse 14 says, that the blessing of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles in Christ Jesus, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. That is all you need. You were once a Gentile, but you are in Christ Jesus, you are linked back to Abraham. And the blessing of Abraham is upon you. And favor is a significant part of the blessing. So you are qualified for favor. Amen. Tell your neighbor, I am qualified for favor. I am qualified for favor. We are the generation that usher in the favor of God. And the set time is now. Amen. Your favor is now. Amen. The set time for God to favor you is now. Amen. We talked about the benefits of favor. I'm not going to go through it. If you need a copy of the slide, I believe it's on our website. If you want to listen to the message again, you can go to YouTube. Hallelujah. Favor is the anointing that takes struggle out of everything. It gives you sweatless victory. It's the anointing that you can really need. If you go anywhere, you need anything. When Fred was giving his testimony, all I can see is the favor of God. Because these people, they're not supposed to be here today. They're supposed to have been back in Nigeria. If they went back to Nigeria, they won't die. They will still somehow survive. But favor of God touched their lives. They got their paper sweatlessly. Hallelujah. I talked about how to trigger favor. We started about that. And I said the only way you can access anything that God has given unto us is through what? By faith. The only way that you can access everything that God, even if it's longevity that you want, if it is, you can't just be taking medication and say, be eating everything. But by faith, once you begin to declare it, God will begin to set you to the in line with His word. So the only way, the first and the most important way to access anything that God has given unto us is by faith. I said faith was what Esther had when she went to the king's court. In the book of Esther chapter 5 verses 1 to 3, when she went to go and look for favor for her people, faith was what she had, because she said, let me go in. You guys pray and fast for me. Let me go in. If I perish, I perish. She went inside. It was not her turn to go into the king's court. But because she knew and she demanded, she put a demand on the favor of God. And when she was coming out, favor was what she had. Hallelujah. I said it is a free gift and it is not the result of luck. I am not lucky. I am favored. Actually, luck comes from Lucifer. So if you are talking, you will never find me telling you, you are lucky. No, you are not lucky. You are favored. We need to begin to change our vocabulary. You need to begin to use the word of God. If anything comes to you by favor, don't say it is luck. It is favor of God. It is not through the law. It must be received by faith. And I said that to walk by faith, you must stop depending on the world system. You need to start depending on God's system. Hallelujah. And His kingdom. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And I said again, to receive favor, to trigger favor, you must line yourself up with the word of God. And you must only obey the word of God. In fact, Brother Fred's preaching has done the whole thing on favor today. Because everything he said, he will say, what has the Lord said? It was difficult for him in the beginning to hear God by himself. So he attached himself to the servant of God who has gone ahead of him to understand the voice of God. But after a while, he knows how to understand the voice of God. Because after a while, you find out that if he's discussing with pastor will now ask him, what did God say to you? And then both of them will now agree with him. We must get to a point where we hear the voice of God and we only obey what the word of God says. That is how to experience the favor of God. Number three, I said change your self-image. And that's where I stopped last week. Your self-image has to do a lot with what God can do for you and how far you can go in life. I use the example of the 12 people that Moses sent to go and look at the land, of the promised land. And when they got there, 10 of them, when they got back, they had a very bad self-image. You see, their self-image did not begin when they got to the land of Canaan. Their bad self-image was inside of them before they went. Because if you started there, then Caleb and Joshua would have seen the same thing. But it was what was inside of them that made them to think that they were grasshoppers. Hallelujah. And now let me tell you something. If a lion lives with a dog, a lion is the king of the forest. But when they came back to that lion and they put that lion with a dog, even the greatness, the kingship or the rulership is in the lion. But if he dwells several years with the lion, he will see that with the dogs, he will see that he will think he's a dog. He will start trying to bark. He will start trying to lick people's feet. He will start doing what lions are not supposed to do, but what dogs do. Hallelujah. But does that mean that that lion is not a lion? Does that mean that if that lion is taken away and brought into the forest and begin to be groomed by a mother or father lion, do you think that greatness can come back out? That is who you are. You need to know that your self-image has to be changed before you can become a favor carrier. Hallelujah. There are many reasons God saved you. To bring glory to himself, to appease his justice, to demonstrate his sovereignty. But one of the sweetest reasons God saved you is because he is fond of you. He likes to have you around him and he thinks you are the best. He created you so that he can bestow his favor upon you. Remember, I said that everything about God is good. The Bible says that all good and perfect gifts come from God. Hallelujah. So every good gift comes from God. And he's always looking to any of his children that will say, I am ready to receive those good gifts. And it is your turn in the name of Jesus. The life and nature of God comes into our lives when we are born again. And this brings us to the class of God. Once you take your mouth and you say, Jesus, you are my Lord, you are my Savior, you have come into the class of God. You now resemble him. That song says, I am fearfully made, I am wonderfully made, I resemble Jesus. Now you now look like God. And no disfavor should be terrorizing you in the name of Jesus. So to appropriate favor in your life, you need to see yourself differently. You need to see yourself differently. The Bible says in the book of Luke chapter 4 verse 19, if you look at it in the Amplified Version, Luke chapter 4 verse 19, Luke 4 19, the Bible says, in verse 18, he's talking about what Jesus Christ has come to. But one thing he says, he has come to proclaim the accepted and acceptable year of the Lord. The day when salvation and the free favors of God profusely abound. For something to be profusely abound means it's a large amount. It is extravagant. It is excess. So you have been engrafted into the extravagant excess favor of God. Change your image. Begin to look at yourself as somebody who has access to profuse favor from God. That means that when you wake up in the morning, there is a situation that you are facing. And that thought comes to you. You begin to be proud because people will look at you and say, you are so proud. Yes. Until you get to the level where people say, who do you think you are? You are so proud. Then you are not walking in where God wants you to be. There is no servant of God that they have not, or nobody that is a Christian that people have not said, you people, you are too, arrogant. Who do you think you are? But once you begin to know that you are into profuse favor, then your image will be changed. You are created to this earth to advance the kingdom, So God bestows favor on you to do this. The reason you are on this earth is not so that you can make babies alone, not so that you can build house alone, but to advance the kingdom of God. You need to have this clearly in your mind that whatever is given unto you is to advance the kingdom of God. When God bestows favor upon you, it is to advance the kingdom of God. When I was speaking with Brother Fred on Tuesday, when they called about their papers, I said, the reason why God is giving you this favor is not so that you can, you know, marry them, but so that the kingdom of God can be advanced, so that people can come to the knowledge of Christ. And they agreed with me. Hallelujah. Because it is the truth. The reason God favors us, not only because he loves us, he wants us to be good, but because he wants more people to be favored. He has so much goodness. He has a lot of goodness that we need to share it with our lives. Hallelujah. Once you know this, you will no longer condemn yourself. Your past will no longer be relevant to you. All the stuff that you have done, even the one that you did yesterday, it should no longer be relevant to you. If you have confessed it, you move on. It doesn't. I was speaking to one of my friends the other day. She lives in the UK. And I was telling her that this is how God sees us. The way that God sees us is that, okay, you messed up, you clean up, you move on. That's all. You mess up, you clean up, you move on. We don't relinquish, we don't condemn ourselves. To appropriate favor, you need to move yourself into a place where you can receive it by grace. Grace does not thrive on condemnation. You cannot get grace, you cannot appropriate grace if you are condemning yourself. No guilt, no shame, no sense of lack. You are the apple of God's eyes, and he has you in his mind all the time. Hallelujah. So change your image from today on. If anybody comes to you and says, what is going on with you? Who are you? Who do you think you are? I am the favored of the Lord. I am blessed and I am highly favored. The goodness of God follows me everywhere I go. Can't you see it all around me? And God is glorified in your life in the name of Jesus. Number five thing that I want to tell you to trigger the favor of God is to change your association. Your association determines your destination. When God calls Abraham, when he called Abraham to give him favor, the first thing that God told to Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, verse 1. Now the Lord said to Abraham, get out of your country. Tell your neighbor, get out. Tell him or her again, get out. There are some associations that you need to get out of. This man, the Lord told him, get out of your country. Get out if your family is not, I'm not saying disown your family. If they are not on the same page with you, you don't need to share your dreams with them. Joseph made that mistake. You don't need to make the mistake. When God is favoring you and showing you revelations about your future and telling you things, get out of your country. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Avoid discouraging associations. But a friend was, he told me a while back about the sister that started talking. This sister was blessed from the church by the grace of God. And I pray that God will lead her to where her destiny is in the name of Jesus. The sister called Brother Fred, met him at the store and started talking bad about the pastor, about the church, about things in the church. But this brother decided to change his association. He said, I'm not going to listen to somebody that would derail me from my destiny. And I know that if he had listened, if he had sat down and started eating the pastor on the dinner plate with her, he would not be where he is today. Hallelujah. So be careful your association. I remember Sister Edith was giving us a message last Friday, and I was just sitting there thinking, thank God it's not me or the pastor that was preaching this message. She was telling us that if somebody has left your church, how come come, they are still your BFFs. What are you talking about? What is your problem? They will call you, they will tell you the reason why they left the church. Let me tell you something. Nobody will talk to you, come and report to you and say, I am guilty. They will tell you their own part of the story and they will color it and dress it and they will sound very, very nice. And then you will look at the person, the other person they are talking about. It will, if it was before me, and I see that person, I'll be like, you did all these things. But I grew up a little bit. Now I know people that you can't just hear one side of the story and go and make judgments over that. But human, that is how human beings are. So if you are associated with the wrong people, change your association. If your destiny is in line with this word of God, change your association. Feed your faith and doubt your fears. How do you feed your faith? Faith comes by hearing. You hear the word of God. If you don't hear the word of God, your faith will not go up. The word of God that you are listening to right now is filling up your faith. You are getting better. But if you stop at here and you get home and you start, you know, looking into fears and all the other stuff, then your fear begins to grow. But if you come back again on Wednesday, you hear the word of God. You come on Wednesday, if you are in the choir of the intercessors and the IT, they said I should not leave them out anymore, that they are part of the church. You know, your faith begins to rise. Hallelujah. So every time you come in the presence of God, at home, you put in a CD, your faith begins to go up. And you feed your faith. And then you begin, if fear comes, you begin to doubt that fear. God will help us in Jesus' name. Amen. The biggest problem Joseph had, I said, was that he told everything that he saw. Some of us, everything that happens in our life, we tell. Facebook, Instagram, Snapchat nowadays, you even take, if you write it, you can deny that somebody took your phone and wrote it. They say Snapchat is, as it is happening, it goes out live. Oh, I just ate coconut. Oh, I just had, I just saw my baby. I just did this. Do you have to give everything out? Hallelujah. Those things are there for you to enjoy and to share communication, but not every communication is worthy to be taken out. Hallelujah. There are some people you should not discuss your dreams with. I've talked about that. So I want you to begin to look at the people around you, the association of the people around you. It's not even only the people. Association with TV. What do you watch on television? What do you want? Those could be part of your association. People you are inviting into your homes. You put Nigerian movie, they are going to Abalis, what do they call them? The people that look into the water or whatever. Baba. They go, you bring that Baba. Do you know that you are bringing that Baba into your own home? The one that you watch day and night, soap opera. You watch it all day. And then you want favor to come. In the soap opera, you find out that if you were like me, when I was in the States, I used to like all my children and want life to live. I watched it all the time. If I was not home, when I recorded Joyce Meyer so that I would balance things up a little bit, I would record all my children so that I could watch it after I finished sharing Joyce Meyer. But I found out that I stopped watching it for several years, coming to Canada, where I was working. The woman that I said I was working with that slapped my face, she loved to watch soap opera too. So and that was the only way to calm her down. Do you know that 15 years later, after I stopped watching soap opera, when she put all my children in, I still remember those things. It's as if nothing stopped. As if I took, I forgot their names now because it's been a while. This guy is still there. This guy is still there. They are still married. No, they divorced and be married again. She started out. What do we get from there? Nothing. There is nothing. Those are associations that we cut ourselves from. And God will help us in the name of Jesus. The next thing I want us to do to be able to trigger the favor of God is to change our attitude. Favor does not work with a bad attitude. Some of us, we are praying, Father, give me favor. Lord, give me favor. If favor meets us in the way and sees our face, favor will turn back. because of the kind of attitude that we have. Your job says, your boss at your work tells you, you know what, I know I hired you to be a manager, but please, can you please wipe this table? And you say, me? Don't you know, you didn't hire me for that? I'm a manager. Then you begin to tell them your resume. Do you know that I used to be a director somewhere? So why are you asking me to clean the table? It may be that your favor is aligned to that cleaning the table, but your attitude has pushed it away. Joseph had a very good attitude when he was put in prison. After Potiphar's wife messed with him and they threw him in the prison, he was the one that saw the faces of the butler and the other guy, the armor bearer, or the cup bearer. He was the one that saw their faces. I saw their faces and said, what is wrong with you? If Joseph had a bad attitude, he would not have seen that the cup bearer and the butler had bad dreams. So, and he was the one that was telling them, no, don't worry about it. This is what the Lord said about this dream. Don't worry about it. You are okay. His attitude was not bad. It was not a bad attitude. A bad attitude is an indication that you are not walking by faith. Worry cancels out favor. Worry cancels out favor. Murmuring and complaining in the front of the children removes the honor and favor and faith in God. You see, this is what I mean by this is, you are expecting something and you are praying to God. Your children see you praying. And then the moment you don't get that thing, you start murmuring, you start complaining. Ah, what kind of God is this? I've been serving God. I've been praying for this thing. And you know, when the children see that, they don't know how to honor God. Because they are like, okay, mommy is high today and she's down tomorrow in this faith thing. So you don't murmur and complain about things that are not there yet. Hallelujah. If God is ready to favor you and your boss is not ready, you don't need to have a bad attitude about it. Let me tell you something. God will remove that boss because favor is on your side. In the name of Jesus. Heartfelt praise qualifies you for fearful blessing. Let's read Psalm 67 verses 5 to 6. Let the people praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. When you praise God heartily, in the midst of situations, in the midst of things that are not working out very well, you are triggering the favor of God. You are asking favor to come to you. So heartfelt praise, when things are not working out, when you are expecting favor and you have not gotten it, praise God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Meditate on the word of God, number 7. By meditating on the word of God, you will discover that the impossible could be made possible. In the book of Joshua chapter 1 verse 8, Joshua chapter 1 verse 8, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. Meditating on the word of God, you look at that scripture, Psalm 102 verse 13. It is my, in fact, in my Bible, I put it there, Psalm 102 verse 13. I put it there, it said, it is time to favor Adedayo. I removed Zion from there, I put my name there. So I now began to meditate on it. It is now time. You will arise and have mercy on Adedayo. It is time to favor her. Now is the same time. You look at scriptures that belong to the, that are, you know, for favor, and you begin to meditate, to speak them out, and you find out that favor begins to be on the increase for you. Now, the level of favor is gradual. It increases. Hallelujah. Because it is the blessing of God, it increases. Your favor today could be like I said last 2 weeks ago, you could be driving down, and then you stop at McDonald's to get your medium coffee double-double. You get there, you want to pay at the window, and the lady said, oh, the guy in front of you has paid for you. You recognize it, you say, that is favor. And you find out that it goes on the increase. The next time you will see that, well, if you are the kind that eats McDonald's, I don't like McDonald's food, but it is junior chicken you want to get, you find out that you've graduated from double-double, somebody paid for double-double, and somebody will just say, they've paid for your junior chicken meal. And it becomes gradual. You begin to get it in English. Just like God increased it from the beginning up until now. And God will favor you in the name of Jesus. Number eight, stay away from sin. Sin repels God. God cannot show up in the atmosphere of sin. God can show up, but he cannot manifest. His presence is everywhere. Where you are doing it, he can see you, but he will not be able to manifest his favor. Joseph could have missed his favorable destiny if he had slept with Mrs. Potiphar. With God. Number nine thing is to forgive easily. Unforgiveness is a blessing blocker. If you are the kind of people that somebody wronged you, if you are like me, if you wrong me, I will shout, blah, 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 blah. But 5 minutes later, if you ask me what that person did, I don't remember anymore. But some people, their book of remembrance is big. In 1938, your grandfather did this, and said, and they will quote it verbatim. And I'm thinking, how do you remember these things? You need to forgive easily. You need to live a life of forgiveness. Let me tell you something. If David did not forgive Saul, he would not be on the throne today. He forgave Saul. And that is the reason he had to call out and ask for Mephibosheth. He showed favor in the family of Mephibosheth. I was telling somebody the other day, I said, one way that I get out of my, if somebody offends me and it's really, really, really tight for me, I will pray for them, and after I've prayed for them, I will give them a gift. Now, don't think if I give you a gift, you are offending me. No, that's not what I'm saying. But because I want it out, if I can give somebody a gift, that means that I'm using my own physical capacity to get rid of that offense from my heart. So, and it's been working for me. It works for me. I will bless you. And that is the same thing that David did. He looked around, forgave Saul, and looked around and said, is there anybody else in the house of Saul that I can show the kindness of God? Not because Saul was good to me. Saul followed him throughout the life of Saul. He didn't agree to him to be the king. Hallelujah. But David chose to forgive. Forgive easily. Keep helping people. Joseph kept helping people in prison, and one of them remembered him later. God used that person to organize the royalty of Joseph. Help people. You don't know who God will send to you to help you. If we find somebody that is in need of something, help them. Don't look away. Oh, you need help? Let me help you. It's not only the pastors that you help. Help one another. We appreciate what you do for us. We appreciate your gestures. But let's help one another, especially those who are in the household of faith. Hallelujah. Do good to people, help people. This will make you attract you to favor. Hallelujah. Yeah. And number 11, which is the last one, is to confess and always expect favor. Psalm 5, verse 12. Psalm 5, verse 12. For you, O Lord, will bless the righteous. With favor, you will surround him as with a shield. Psalm 102, verse 13. I've read that before. Ruth chapter 2, verses 1 to 2. Ruth chapter 2, verses 1 to 2. There was a relative of Naomi's husband, a man of great wealth, of the family of Elimelech. His name was Boaz. So Ruth the Moabite said to Naomi, please, let me go to the field and glean heads of grain after him, in whose sight I may find favor. And Naomi said, go, my daughter. She confessed favor. She had never met any of the relatives. But once, and you know the story, if you don't know the story of Ruth and Boaz, go and read it in the book of Ruth. It talks about favor of God. She was a Gentile. She had no connection with the heritage of Israel. But because of the fact that she knew the God Naomi, who didn't even know who her God was, but Ruth knew Naomi's God better than Naomi did. And she followed her and she made this confession. Confess favor. You cannot rise above your confession. There is nothing you say that will get above your confession. Confession is the mother of manifestation. Once you confess it, favor follow me today. As I'm going out today, favor will come with me. And you expect it, you will find out that favor will come to you. So what you cannot confess cannot be handed over to you. As a woman, confess that you are a favor to your husband. Doesn't the Bible say in Proverbs chapter 18, verse 22? Proverbs chapter 18, verse 22. He who finds a wife finds a good thing and obtains favor from the Lord. What I always say is, whatever I will need to use to be a favor to my husband, Lord, provide for me. Because I want to be a favor. So I confess that to my husband, I will be a favor to him. So when he wants to talk about me, or when he wants to think about me, he starts thinking about me as a favor. As a man, confess that you have received favor from God. Not that stupid, idiot woman. No. She is favored from God for you. Even if she's not looking favorable, even if she's not acting right now, the more you confess it, I'm sure Pastor confessed so much favor after we got married, confessing me to be favored. Hallelujah. And then my eyes began to open and I began to see myself as favored. And now I'm confessing it for myself too. And you as a man, confess your wife, bring the favor out of her. And God will help us in the name of Jesus. Make a choice or place a demand on favor by confessing it. Make a choice to speak divine favor onto your life and watch God move on your behalf. Make a choice to speak divine favor into your life and watch God move on your behalf. The devil tries to cut off your faith so you don't appropriate divine favor. Don't let him. You may live around those who don't understand favor. Don't let them discourage you. Confess it. Favor starts with one level and increases to the next level. Once you begin to confess it, you get to one level and it increases to the next level. And the greater your confession, the more frequent your confession of favor is, the more you begin to see favor coming to you. And it shall be so in your life in the name of Jesus. You know you can wear favor as a garment. That everywhere you go, you will just see that you smell like favor. People just begin to say, I just want to do this thing for you. I don't know why I'm doing it. I just want to do it. If I tell you, if you appropriate these 11 things that I have talked about, ways to trigger the favor of God, you will find out that perpetually favor will be your portion. In the name of Jesus. You are favored. You are highly favored. I say you are favored. You are highly favored. The fragrance of favor emanates from you in the name of Jesus. Rise up with me this afternoon. Let's make this confession again. Hallelujah. Let's make the confession. Bring up, okay, thank you. Say with me, in the name of Jesus, I decree that from this moment forward, I see myself the way God sees me. Shut up.